I start with one premise that human body is the best example of information and communication technology. The whole thing is here. The whole information is there, communication is there, decision making is there, and this is a perfect example of this technology. Inclusive development, growth, there has been confusion, and I want to clarify because I have worked on development of Eastern Uttar Pradesh, and when we were trying to model an example for 15 districts, I encountered a problem because development is an elusive term. Whose development? If you go to village, to gaon bhi khandit hai, wahan par bhi chamrauti hai, bharauti hai, ye hai, wo hai, to kiska vikas karna, kiska nahi karna, all these problems are coming. So we have to be very careful in defining what we mean by the term development. It's an elusive term. What I understand from inclusive development is that it includes the availability of the whatever fruits of economic activity and empowerment to everybody. That is what I understand by inclusive growth or inclusive development. With these two premises, I want to move to. So you can see, I'll just read out. And then we can see that this is tool provided by ICT. These are the tools which are provided by ICT. So information and communication technologies covers three areas, namely telecommunication, broadcasting, and internet. That is international computer network. ICT consists of all technical means used to handle information and aid communication, including computer and network, hardware and communication middleware, as well as software. Thus, by very nature of technology, it provides advantage of enhanced visibility. You can see it provides enhanced visibility, networking potential, accessibility of information and communication. So, by these tools. So, this is what it means to. The term ICT is now used to refer to merging of audio, visual and telephone network with computer network through a single cable of link system. It refers to all kind of technologies which enable users to create, access, and manipulate information. Thus, it is an enabling technology because you can create, you can access, and you can manipulate. So it's an enabling technology. The inherent potential of this technology has resulted into widespread of use of this technology worldwide. India has, let's say, 750 million mobile phone users, and according to senior manager Yahoo India, there are 8 crore net users in the country, which would increase to 24 crore by 2015. A change in present uses would occur in future as more and more people will use net with mobile devices. As 3G handsets become cheaper, mobile internet would be next big thing in the country, which would penetrate to remote corners of the country. These things will happen, I mean, evident. The advantage offered by ICT can be gainfully. Now, there is this. I am presenting ICT as a tool. It's a tool. And now it can be gainfully utilized for finding solutions to the problems in many domains. According to NASSCOM paper, that is Perspective 2020, ICT enabled solutions in healthcare, education, financial services, and public services can drive socio-economic inclusion of 30 million citizens each year, faster, cheaper, and more effectively than traditional model. But to achieve this, we need to look for innovation and entrepreneurship in ICT. Innovation. India is a multicultural, multilingual country. We have population of over 60% living in villages. Lack of education and basic civic amenities characterize these villages. Most ICT for development applications are still heavily dependent on initiative of already covered. That's the problem with ICT. They have been characterized by already covered, converted, and are often not mainstreamed beyond their areas of initiative or responsibility. Whoever made it, for whatever responsibility he was given, he has made the ICT according to that. But that's not the limitation of technology per se. These applications furthermore often underperform and prove unsuitable if they are not part of broader national ICT strategy. So strategy is needed to broader this tool into enabling technology for the mainstream. Therefore, these applications need to be modified, altered to suit the user's need. That's where innovation and entrepreneurship comes about. By innovation, we mean here a creative idea having impact on society and economy. It may be linked to adaptation of technology to suit the need, improvement in quality, productivity, service, or efficiency and competitive positioning, etc. It involves thinking differently, creatively, and insightfully. It fulfills unmet needs for conventional product processes, institutional forms. We need innovation meeting the challenges of poverty, reduction and inclusive growth with sustainability. Growth and inclusive growth have to be co-equal objective, as GDP growth alone can never be an end in itself. It is no end. If you have more GDP, it makes no sense at all. It is a meaningless thing. So I say it should have co-equal objective. Inclusive growth does not mean poverty reduction, but empowerment, and includes access to services and opportunities. It can come through greater access to expanding opportunities emerging from economic activity. So that we have to expand. So that is where I had put four models. And I have put financial inclusion and m-banking, agriculture and weather forecasting, public services and governance, healthcare and education. Now, since public services has been talked about, healthcare has also been talked about. I will be going through quickly. But financial inclusion is a part of national agenda of the government for growth and development. This is agenda. In the 11th five-year plan also, it was the agenda. Now, there are several central and state government welfare schemes amounting to 40,000 crore operational in rural areas. In our country, only 40% of our population is having our bank account. The majority of the people excluded from access to financial product and services are poor and illiterates. The marginal farmers, landless laborers, working in unorganized sector, urban slum dwellers, and migrants, etc., are excluded groups. The recent advances in technology have transformed the banking from its traditional form. A number of startups are working, it has been said, for financial inclusion as well, and are using ICT technology to develop last mile connectivity to rural and unbanked customers for their own reasons. Now, I'm not saying that they have their intention to empower everybody, but the technology is being taken to that place. Technology is available at that place. These companies are also building a range of products and services ranging from low-cost ATM to mobile money transfer schemes. This technology reduces cost of convenient real-time financial transaction, expands access points, lessens need to carry cash, and attracts unbanked customers. The financial inclusion for illiterate or otherwise can be ensured by biometric identification. Every citizen of India can get. There was a problem of authentication, there was a problem of secrecy. So I say every citizen of India can get universal identification number. Now this can be combined with person's photograph, fingerprints, iris scan to make the financial transaction fail safe. It can be also worked, the same system can work in healthcare. The financial inclusion will result in development of IC enabled micro enterprises, both in software and hardware. I mean, I am not a person who believes software can only be done by urban people. The educated slum, educated people, students in rural areas can also develop a lot of software. In fact, they can develop software which are needed for our needs. If the government organizations fund the startups and provide incentive to develop new technologies, it can lead to a lot of economic activities resulting into inclusive growth. Agricultural assistance. E-agriculture is an emerging field, focusing on enhancement of agriculture and rural development through improved ICT. The main phase of agricultural industry are cultivation of land, testing of soil.
So we are slide on e-agriculture has not come in now.
Yeah, I've forgotten.
There's no slide.
There's no slide. I forgot to make. So I'll just read out. What are the main phases? Water cultivation of land, testing of soil, weather prediction, water management, fertilizer management, pest control. Now, in e-business, data on market, transport of food grains and other products, food preservation, processing, validation, quality management, marketing are crucial to growth. All stakeholders of agriculture industry need information and knowledge about these phases to manage them efficiently. The government of satellite data are available on land records, weather records, and all these things are there. Another agency is holding the records and of the market and transportability. CSI has several technologies for all these things, but they are discreetly. Now, kiosks can be developed to get this information. So an application of ICT can come in a client-server technology. So that ICT would enable getting accurate, complete, concise information in time and for time information and knowledge for making right decisions. There could be dedicated Kisan portal. This is not there. There could be a dedicated Kisan portal linking various other websites giving information needed by farmer. But the information provided by system must be in user-friendly form, easy to access, cost-effective, and well-protected from unauthorized access. The ICT technology will provide access to market without middlemen. Village kiosks could be developed to provide important information on these. In a knowledge-driven economy, access to information is vital to the growth and entrepreneurship. The business scenario will change dramatically in this decade. This decade will demand enhanced skills, innovation, and entrepreneurship development. I'm skipping public services completely from my this thing. Only two things I want to mention about public services. Number one, most of the farmers or villagers waste a lot of time going every day for two things. FIR likhwana hai and court jana hai. And every time they go only to find out that the judge sahab is on leave. So all these things are big bottlenecks, and they can be easily addressed by ICT. But where I want to emphasize is that all these in empowerment, because you have to, if you have to change, the empowerment will come through education. I am a strong believer that you just cannot help everybody, but you can empower everybody with education, and that education will give sufficient scope for innovating by everybody. Instead of we deciding what should be there in villages, they themselves will decide what is needed by them, and they know it better. So the education is a big gainer through ICT. Now this, because in education, we have, you can have ubiquitous learning environment can be accessed in various contexts. Mobile learning is possible, personalized learning, teacher-generated open context, learning through white, all these are. I'm leaving out, again, healthcare for time, this thing. I'll only say bottleneck. To put it simply, it means those who have access to ICT, digital device is a bottleneck, and it is affecting the use. Now, access to education and development of some of the basic skills in computing would address this problem. To an extent, people are able to reap the benefit of this technology. This disability or bottleneck can be addressed by content creation in local languages, enabling the operation and services through voice mode and PIN cum biometric authentication. These are the three, four solutions. Power is another this thing. The availability of power is a major bottleneck, particularly in rural areas. If we look at the plans for power generation for this decade, the demand does not meet supply. This leads us to look for an alternative renewable energy. There are plenty of resources of energy in villages. In fact, agricultural waste, cow dung waste, and biomass coupled with solar, photovoltaic, and thermal can supply enough energy to meet the household and other micro-industrial demands of the villages. The switching rural India onto renewable sources could help the country bridge its widening energy gap. In fact, entire livestock, the amount of cow dung which is available, it can create 75,000 megawatts of power, which is half the installed capacity of India. And the manure created by that can be utilized in the entire cultivated field of India twice over. These are cold statistics, but the fertilizer lobby and the petroleum lobby will just not allow it to happen. These are cold things. There is just 2 days before, when I was preparing this, I received this application. The Union Bank of India unveils a solar-powered, wires-enabled biometric rural ATM at Ghawadi village in Ludhiana district, Punjab. I am very happy about it, because this is what I have been thinking, because I feel unwired village is possible, locally, totally available from rural energy. Thank you very much. I think I